Hello and welcome to Latest Homes Live. I Want to Live Here. I'm Andrew Kay.
And I'm Andy Garth.
We've got a slightly different show this week. We're not going to show you any new properties, but we are going to look back at some of the better interviews that we've had over the last few months. But before we do that, I've just seen an amazing film that Latest Television have made for a client, and I'd like you to watch it as well.
It'd be a great pleasure.
Let's take a look at that.
What I believe we've created is a community space that is welcoming and open to all. Had you come here only 2 or 3 years ago, it was far from amazing. It just became a very sad, dark, dank building, plus the fact it was made of bungaroosh and we had leaking roofs and leaking walls, and in the end we literally had to close it down and move out. ZSTA were professional from beginning to end and totally got the fact that we had a very limited budget and we could not afford to spend a penny more. I don't really want to talk about God and miracles, but for me it was a miracle that we actually not only managed to raise the funds that we needed, find the team that we could work with, get it built on time and on budget, and have this amazing place that we now use on a weekly basis, on a daily basis. So it really is nothing short of a miracle.
So we started ZSTA in 2013. How do you think it's gone?
Well, I think we're continuing to build a brand awareness. And more importantly, I think we've met some fantastic clients and consultants.
I think the collaborations and diversity of our work has been most satisfying.
For me, I think we've also had some good project outcomes. So I think all in all, pretty good start.
Yeah. We continue to push forward with our research focus, and we've, as you know, we've got an excellent team, really experienced, and I think we'll continue to build on our reputation.
I think we can build a real strong bond of trust with our clients. That's what I'm looking forward to, and getting a real reputation for quality in our work.
Yeah.
Our team is the real substance to our enterprise, delivering on our clients' design aspirations. We are first and foremost designers and recognise that successful outcomes come from placing our clients at the heart of the design process. At early stages, we consider our designs through exploration of the brief. Hand drawing is more immediate and helps us feel around the solutions.
We also use 3D modelling to test ideas even at the very outset of a project. As with many in the industry, we are on the journey towards BIM compliance.
We don't work inside a bubble. It's often our outside pursuits that sustain the passion in our work.
This is our workshop. We predominantly manufacture, design and build bespoke furniture for residential and commercial purpose. Brighton is a relatively small place. I work with a lot of interior decorators, designers, architects, and they will come to us for an idea. If they're redeveloping a new house or building a new house, they'll come to us to collaborate or bring new ideas to furnishing that home. I had done a tender for the Dome box office, the ticket office. Normally, my business evolves just about my decision making and what I put down on paper. And this, for a long time, was the first time that I went to a meeting, sat in a room with 8 other people, all with individual ideas, all with their own thought processes and creative nuances towards the big idea. It's good fun.
Our latest venture is to invite ideas on Twitter for improving our city. Hashtag Bright50.
I've been really impressed with how ZST has understood what we do. We see a youth club as a place that we want young people to feel that they belong here and they have a stake in it. So the relationship with the building and who else is in here is absolutely critical. And I think ZST have done a really good job at understanding that. There's been really interesting suggestions about how the space can be made to work and help us build those relationships. We're really excited. I think it's an important project for Brighton. It's not just the building, but it's what the building could make possible.
ZST Architects currently work nationally and internationally. We are also specialists in numerous sectors. We actively research trends and new products to keep our interior design consultancy fresh. This has been useful for our clients with grand design ambitions.
We believe passionately about when we design an interior that every decision we make is based on the customer experience, the point they enter through the space, all the way through to the point they leave. And here at 64 Degrees, the whole experience was about the food and the kitchen and the excitement and buzz of seeing the chefs actually creating the meals. So really, the interior almost had to take a bit of a back seat in that. It's a small restaurant, and we decided to actually create the kitchen right in the heart of the restaurant and put a big seating area around the bar. So basically, the chefs have absolutely nowhere to hide. And so there's a sort of honesty about the design, and so that's what we took into the materials and the finishes. We sort of pared everything back and created quite an honest palette of materials. We got sort of raw timbers, dark concrete, and bits of copper. But really, the whole story is about the excitement that's going on at the kitchen, and that's what creates the buzz and the whole experience for the customer.
We are certified Passive House designers. For us, sustainability is built in and not bolted on. Community projects are also close to our heart. We are used to working collaboratively and building consensus. Residential development excites us. Our bespoke projects give us real insight into what people want.
Our tourism and hospitality work has transported us to Switzerland, Spain, Dubai, UAE, Isle of Wight. Our leisure work is also complementary. With our first education project near complete, our team are keen to build on their extensive past experience. We're experienced team members within consortia for large mixed-use regeneration schemes.
From all at ZST Architects,
Alex,
Pete,
Hannah,
Vicky,
Tom,
Richard,
Nick,
Nicola,
Sophie,
Mona,
John,
Rachel,
Sam,
we would like to say
thank you!
I think one of the best interviews we've had this season has been with the guys from ZSTA Architects. So let's view that again.
I'm delighted to introduce Richard Zinzan and Nick Stickland from ZSTA. Thank you for joining us today.
Hello, thank you.
You're welcome. It's an extraordinary business that you're in. I was most thrilled in the first few minutes of the film to see you drawing with a pen, because there's so little of it going on. And clearly that's very important to you in the process.
Absolutely. I think, as we said in the film, it's all about feeling around things, and we use it as an exploration. I think clients sometimes think that we come with, you know, fully formed
ready to go,
and that actually we're going to, you know, thrust these ideas upon people, and that in some way we have the sort of we're slightly egotistical maybe in that way, but actually it is about the exploration of the brief with the client, and sketching helps do that. It helps sort of draw ideas out.
I think what obviously it's a fairly short film into what you do, but something like the synagogue example, you would have spent man hours in there just getting the feel for it and looking at it, and because you can't just do it by going in there once. And
no, you spend a lot of time with the client and understanding them and their needs, and that's really important for us as architects. We need to understand what they want, but also getting to know them is important.
I think it's little understood that actually when it comes to any form of creative commission and work, the brief is the king. And if you don't get the brief right, then you're never going to get the job right.
Absolutely. I actually spent a week living with a client once when they were
fantastic.
We were designing a new house for them in Barbados. Of course, we've got to go to Barbados.
Oh, sorry.
Slightly scammy. Thank you very much, Richard.
But it was a really interesting experience, because you have conversations with your clients around, you know, in the office, but you don't really understand how they live. And when you live with them, you really get to know them and you know, how they operate within the home. And so that really helped inform the design, and we delivered something that they really wanted.
I sort of get that with you, because with your cooking, for example, you know, if no one really knew how, you know, into it you were, they'd go, well, we're going to do a kitchen. So you
another one of my many, very many threads.
But
here.
But
I think it is important, you're right. Yeah. And I think, you know, I mean, I trained as a designer as well, and I recognised within my first 6 months of working professionally as a book designer that actually if you weren't able to extract the brief, you were never going to be any good at the job. Mm. Ever, because you'd be ploughing your own furrow. And it's really nice to see that actually for you, you recognise the need of your client. But also I think the other need is about sticking to that budget And it was wonderful to see the lady from the synagogue who was so delighted that you'd done that. It was very tight, is that right?
It was tight, and they were a wonderful client, but they made it very, very clear to us that that was a limited budget and that we had to work within it. So that was our challenge. That's what we had to...
So if you go over, does that start coming out of your fee?
Yeah, I doubt that.
I did notice there was some local initiatives that you've done on there, which we have spoken about earlier. And I did look at your website, and it's not come up on the screen, that you sponsored something in the Brighton Festival this year as well, didn't you?
We did, yeah. We sponsored one of the events put on by Spy Monkey, yeah. Shakespeare's Complete Deaths.
But I think what that I was trying to get to was your commitment to the city itself.
Absolutely.
In promoting it, although you do go to Barbados, you still very much looking at stuff like Edward Street and the gasworks and all sorts of things, which is great for us because obviously we
started a collective a long time ago, actually before even ZSTA was formed, and we knew each other, and this collective was a group of construction professionals within the city. And everything about it was just to look at ideas for locations that had stalled, where we thought, well, let's just put ideas forward, let's provoke discussion, let's catalyse something around it. And it is all about this sort of vested interest we have in seeing our city prosper. And we didn't necessarily say that we had to own those ideas, we just wanted to put them out there and see what would happen with them. And we maintain that sort of ethos today. I mean, you also saw on the film with the Bright 50 campaign.
Yeah.
That's very much what that's about. It's a Twitter campaign where anybody can actually just photograph something within our city, upload it with the hashtag Bright 50, with a bit of description. It could be, this corner could do with a bin because there's litter. It could be a grand design. It's anything, but it's about fundamentally being positive about...
You seem to invest quite a lot of your time in concepts, in ideas that aren't actually commissions, but are visions that you have of how we could improve our environment, and particularly Brighton and Hove. We've all loved the film. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's going to be the most fascinating project. Of course, they've now got to deliver it.
Yeah,
but let's have a listen to Nikki talking about the project again.
Well, we're delighted to be joined on the programme today by Nicholas Rowan. Nicholas is one of the co-owners of Moshimo Restaurant, which is in the heart of the city in Bartholomew Square. How long have you had the restaurant there now, Nicholas?
Since around this time in 2000, so it's 16 years old.
So is it a Japanese restaurant then?
Yeah, it was the first real sushi bar outside of London, actually. We were pioneers both in London, where we were the first conveyor belt sushi bar in London in 1994, and then we were the first to come out of London and came to Brighton.
Wow. It's a great achievement for any restaurant to sustain that many years in this industry, which is notoriously fickle and very, very volatile. To what do you put down that success?
Well, actually, usually I've noticed as restaurants open, they have the kind of sort of trajectory where they are very full for about a year and then they kind of reach their plateau and then slowly decline. Well, we were very different from that. Actually, when we opened, we were pretty much empty. People weren't ready for sushi at all. And so we had to work really, really hard on embedding ourselves in the community, marketing ourselves. And I think Brighton really responds to businesses that are put back into the community. And anybody who knows Moshimo and Brighton will know that we're very, very much at the heart of the city.
You did actually take on a site in the city, which I would always refer to as being a restaurant black spot. It had been a very, very dull cafe, the Pavilion Cafe, for years, and in that architectural style that is sort of faux Victorian, early Edwardian, it was horrible. And you turned the prospects of that space in the city centre on its head and turned it into a really desirable place to go. How difficult was it to do that?
Well, it's very interesting you mentioned that, and I do refer to it always with our latest plans. I mean, I'm a big, big believer in architecture. So when we did take over that kind of round pavilion-style building, I mean, even the estate agents were kind of telling us behind their hand not to take it on. I mean, it had gone bust 7 times in as many years, and it really was a backwater. It was dreadful. And what we did was we decided that it was worth us taking it because the rent was cheap, it was very central, but what we had to do was to create a piece of magnetic architecture that would bring people into the square.
It's, the building itself looks
How difficult was it actually to get permission to do what you did to it?
It was difficult, I have to say. I mean, you know, it took about a year and a half, and I had to use quite an aggressive technique with the planning department in those days, where basically I said, if you don't let me do what I want to do, then we'll just walk away from the building. And of course, you know, they knew as well as I did that the building that was there was...
You needed regeneration desperately. Yeah. And of course, as the city caretakers, they have to make sure that these inner city spaces are potentially going to be used properly, used effectively.
I mean, it was a very interesting thing when we started talking about how we might develop the site further. The planning officer, you know, during our talks, was very reluctant to get rid of that arm, that metal arm, into which the front walls slide. I mean, one of the amazing things about the restaurant is that you can open up the entire front wall, as you know.
It almost becomes a garden restaurant, which is lovely. Wow. And it sort of brings us round to the fact that actually, after some planning time in your own heads, you've actually put forward now a new development of the site with an amazing sky bar.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about that? Where did this idea come about?
Well, I think it came about in long discussions with the council. I had a number of meetings over the years with the chief planning officer at the council asking, you know, what, come on, you know, this isn't good enough. The square still looks tawdry. It's no one ever goes into it other than through into our restaurant. There's a lot of rough sleeping going on. There's it's actually rather unsavory in the evening. We found two dead bodies there in the time that we've been there. I mean, when we first went there, there wasn't even any street lighting.
No. So exactly how is the structure working? I see from the image, and we can see it on the screen behind us here.
Yeah.
It's an amazing platform in the sky. I see there's a sort of twisted pillar which rises out of the existing Machimo. Is that the access?
Yes,
is there
that
a
will
lift
be the
in
access.
There or a staircase or both?
There's both. I think one of the reasons why we did that is that kind of sculptural element that brings people up into the upper echelons. Well, I mean, you asked earlier about where it came from. Well, I was given kind of permission to look at a second floor of the restaurant. Right. And we did look at that. But of course, you know, we always came up against this problem, which was that if you build immediately above the restaurant, then the view would be so depressing. It's
Absolutely.
Like being in Dresden.
Oh, I see.
So I thought one day...
Not that there's anything wrong with Dresden. We love Dresden.
Well, I don't know. Have you been to the city centre?
Yes. That's quite innovative then to...
Well, I just thought, well, why not build a second floor but separate it with sea views?
In terms of the design, who came up with this design? Because it's quite unusual.
Well, we did. We've come.
Okay.
And the space when you get up to that level is bar and dining.
Predominantly restaurant.
Predominantly restaurant.
Yeah, I think for licensing reasons, we will be, you know, people will have to eat to go up there.
And how long will it take for this sky bar to be finished?
Well, what's interesting about it and what's so exciting about it is that the entire thing can be manufactured off-site. And I mean,
and
the
just
idea.
Dropped in.
Yes, dropped in. So it'll be arrive in a ship.
We have a lot of people coming into the studio to talk to us about sales, but as big a part of the market is lettings, and I'm delighted to welcome in Kim White from West Beach Properties. Hello, Kim. Welcome to Latest Homes Live. You're based in Hove, and your property company is West Beach Properties. Tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, we opened up in June this year, and West Beach Properties, where we're located along Victoria Terrace, is where I wanted to be, which is right on the seafront, being the only parade that's close to the beach hence the name West Beach.
It is a proper parade of shops, actually, isn't it? It's an unusual thing in Brighton.
It's fantastic because you're part of the buildings that are behind are beautiful. You forget they're listed buildings. But that's quite good for you, I think, because obviously the amount of stuff that's going to go on, hopefully, there very soon, is in the right place, I think. You picked it sort of an early shout.
Yes, that's all going to go.
And your focus is, of course, lettings.
Lettings, yes, that's what I've predominantly been in, and sales over the 20 years. And with the holiday lets that I've researched over about three and a half years, I wanted to put that into practice, and that has been proved quite popular.
So are holiday lets proving to be a large part of what you do now?
It's a mixture of both, to be perfectly honest.
I mean, the holiday lets is the thing, isn't it, at the moment? I mean, it just seems to me that there's such a good market for it because people come down. So you're doing so it's really short-term let stuff, isn't it? Sort of even weekends and weeks and months rather than your six-month or your annual tenancy on your long stuff. And is there plenty of that about? Are you doing it just in your area or are you all over the place?
I am covering all over, to be perfectly honest, also taken on a really nice one, hopefully in the Brighton area, or central Brighton, which is obviously very popular.
Yes.
Hove and just off the seafront there.
So how far do you... So you're quite happy to sort of go west and east and such and north. Do you go back into Hove much or...?
Yes, I do. We have guests stay for a number of reasons, and in particular, I've got guests staying with us at the moment, and that's in the Hangleton area.
Oh, right, so it is everywhere.
Oh, so quite a long way out. I would have thought with a holiday let that people want to actually be within 5 minutes of the beach.
On the West Beach.
Or 5 minutes of the nightclubs, because actually that is a large part of the lure of Brighton as a holiday resort. It's our nighttime economy.
That's right. I have found that different guests for different number of reasons, this one in particular for the Hangleton one, is that the owner wanted to go back to Australia for a couple of months for travel over the Christmas holidays, because in Australia it's their summer and it's very nice.
So you're taking a vacation yourself and you're making money out of your home while you're away.
Do you get a lot of that? Because I know people that do actually go away for weekends to rent their house.
Yes.
Because there's such demand for it. Do you get people going, oh, actually, we're going away for a week, can you rent it out for a week?
Well, coming up to the Christmas holidays, it's a very popular time, especially for people wanting to... I myself and my children have been away at Christmas, and we loved it, to be perfectly honest.
But you can sort of part-fund your holiday if you're able to let your home.
Yes, you can. And, as I say, it paid for a majority of all of his flights. Right. And basically...
Why wouldn't you?
And it helped out this family. Basically, I had a call from an estate agent in Hove that basically passed on our details to them because in this situation, a sale was about to fall through, that they couldn't move out in time. Mm. So it works really well.
But do you do from start to finish? So you will... advertise it as a short-term let, holiday let. Will you then manage it for that period of time? Will you be the person responsible that if there is a problem with X, Y, and Z, that's what you do? So you put the package together to make sure that you're overseeing. So the guy's gone to Australia for 2 months. Are you the point of call for those tenants?
Yes, I am.
Right.
So it's a full management process.
It's a full-time thing, and I'm on call 24 hours.
I often wondered that about being a letting agent. You know, you have to have emergency numbers, don't you?
Yes,
and so that's you in this case.
Yes, and there's good security companies in Brighton that you can use as well. So.
How has the lettings industry in that area of holidays been affected by the phenomenon that is Airbnb?
Airbnb is a very, very popular. It's sort of kind of overtaken the world, as it were.
Absolutely.
it's like the Google, isn't it, of the holiday market. Airbnb works very, very well, and we've also had clients that I'm still quite happy for them to still use Airbnb because obviously they can manage.
So you can balance that for...
I can come in the middle and fill in the gaps for them.
So like the marketing. Cleaning and the marketing,
The marketing on the other side. We also use TripAdvisor and a few other people. And we just deal and help with the management side if they don't have that.
It's absolutely fascinating because what we're seeing is that you're in a position really here to help people market their home to let on a very short-term basis, maximise on it while you're going away.
Yes.
Make some money.
Well, I think that's what we forget, that you could go to a hotel, people, and that seems to sort of drifted away because although you still get good money to rent it out. It's just that thing of being able to walk in and not have to worry about being late or having keys or anything else. You're in this house. Do you get, I mean, seriously, do you get much sort of aftermath, as in sort of, God, I've got to sort this out on a Monday morning?
Not really. to be perfectly honest.
You're putting the world at rest there, saying to them, it can happen. And we know it can happen. There can be messes. But you're in the position to manage that and to manage that for your clients.
That's right.
I think it's a fascinating area. Thank you for joining us today.
That's okay.
I hope you'll come back and talk again.
Okay, thank you.
Sadly, that's all we've got time for this week. So for now, this is Andrew Kay.
And I'm Andy Garth.
And remember, this is Latest Homes Live.
We want to live here.